Thank you, Mr. Ramesh Dhatlaji. I think some very important, interesting points have been raised besides the initiative which ELICO has taken and what Professor Premwath was talking in his opening remark in terms of the strategic partnership between institutions and universities and industry is what we have seen as to how ELICO is taking this forward. And the more important thing is we should not be expecting the results immediately. Yes. The moment there is a partnership, if we are expecting immediate outcomes out of that, that is something which wouldn't be in the true spirit of a partnership which it should be. Besides the fact that what industry is looking for in terms of the skills and the employability, which is an issue of debate, this aspect was also touched. And the fact and an input for us who are conducting this survey as to how difficult it is for institutions to submit the data. I do realize this fact, and we have got these inputs that it's a voluminous work in terms of the documents that need to be presented by the institutions. But as we were discussing the other day, in fact, what is the outcome of these 4 years of work that we have been doing? And one of the outcomes which we all agreed was that those institutions who have regularly participated in these surveys, they have created a very good documentation framework of how an industry institute interaction ought to be documented, because this is going to be continuous for years together. So a very good documentation has been created, at least in those institutions who have participated in this survey, is the first outcome that we have visibly seen in these institutions. Now, just to carry forward this dialogue, we have already seen 4 years of institutional participation. Now, my query to my other panelists would be how we can carry this forward, number one, and number two, what is the specific role of industry that they are looking based on this inputs of 4 years of participation? Industry, institute, a regulator like AICT, and the government also. So each of these stakeholders, what is the expectations from each of these stakeholders? I'll start with Professor Ayman.
Okay. Well, I think one immediate expansion of the current survey that you're doing, one thing's for sure, that I'm not undermining the outcome of your survey. I'm saying the inadequacy of the coverage it has for an institution, for a country having 8,000 engineering colleges, 37 site visited and 24 recognized, is good thing, but it's not going to change a quantum change in the kind of proportion that the country needs, and therefore a mindset change is what actually, is a reverse mindset change where industry recognizes it. And indeed, what I must say this, that globally, institutions and companies, when the interaction is good, both are doing very well. All great private universities in US, very strong correlation linkages with their industry counterpart. It's a win-win proposition, and only win-win proposition can sustain. Therefore, that mindset change is not one is giving, the other is receiving. That giver and recipient mindset is not going to be sustainable and cannot really inspire confidence in both the parties. So it has to be realized that improving the employability is a common shared goal, as much relevant to academics as to the industry and to the country. And if that's a common shared goal, let this be co-created toward joint effort, which nobody is gaining or losing. It's a win-win proposition. This mindset change is what is important. Second important point that we can do, change the, for example, what we did once since, I've been associated with this TQM awards in national level, and there was a MEET quality, we call it quality recognition award. So inclusive, for example, you say level 1, level 2, level 3, the fact remains that the level, current level of interaction is pathetically low. Therefore, if you only award the winner, it's going to be so few. So you say level 1 is the awareness. Institutions which have shown as a as an important policy intervention that is a strategic alliance with a company or an industry is a part of their mission statement, and we'll give them level 1 recognition for the initiative that they've recognized the need for it. And this is inclusive, so that if there are thousands of them in it, we'll be happy, more the merrier, because that's what the end result would be. So level 1, level 2 is that enabler is leading to some tangible improvement in employability, level 2, level 3, and finally the winner, that means, and this I've seen, in fact, I've developed a system dynamics model, where developed these policy scenarios, and my studies prove that a proactive approach by the industry with an enhancement of employability as a shared objective, up to 7 years the industry might have to spend money, but after 7 years it becomes a paying proposition. So that degree of patience is needed, because we cannot expect quick myopic results tomorrow, and therefore that kind of patience, as we, which in fact Mr. Ramesh Dhatra also mentioned, and this study proves that a proactive hand-holding by the companies after 7 years is going to be absolutely even beneficial even to the company, not only to the academic institution, and for the country it is great, because the low employability is going to be, you know, that demographic dividend would actually be demographic disaster unless we improve the employability of the graduates, because we can't live with 25% employability and aim for a peaceful society. It's not going to happen. Yes. So it's a win-win-win.
Yeah. In the meanwhile, I feel we can have a few questions also, if somebody, based on whatever has happened so far on in this panel. Yes, please. Can we have somebody to share the mic?
Hello. I'm from the industry, basically the mining industry. You see, the basic problem is now that engineering graduates of different fields are going in one direction. This has to be stopped. Because the country is starving for mining engineers, though we have got ISM and so many institutes are there, but all of them are going to either IT or computer science. Mechanical people are also going. So, whereas we are creating a lot of engineering graduates, but the direction of the employability is in one, maybe one or two maximum. Secondly, the industry is very comfortable with class 10th with some skills. The person who comes to my place for Hitachi air conditioner is just a 10th pass, he's not even an ITI or a diploma holder, and he does the job in 10 minutes and takes 500 rupees for the service. Same thing for the doctor, gets 500 rupees. This man is also getting 10th pass, is also getting 500. So why the engineering graduates are required? So the industry does not require engineering graduates, the industry requires class 10th plus some skills. This is one of the major problems we are having, that our engineering students are not getting the jobs, because we are producing about 12 lakhs. And actual jobs are coming about 7.5 lakh, 2 lakhs. So 10 lakhs are basically the diploma holders which has been upgraded to engineering colleges. So it has to be restricted. So this is one of the reasons that engineering colleges are closing. Students are not coming to the engineering and management. Because from class 12 they know that if I learn a little bit of computer or a little bit of electrical, I can earn 200 rupees for one visit. The electrician comes, charges 200 rupees. Whereas after the graduation, he gets a job of only 1.5 lakh rupees per annum. So this is the basic thing the industry what is offering and what we are expecting, the society. So you have to find this gap, why this is a coming up.
Yeah.
Any comments? Can I? Okay. Yeah. No, actually, if industry lives with this perception that they don't need engineers and a 10th standard will do, perhaps they don't realize what they are feeling. Because nobody can be competitive globally unless there is an intellectual input into the R&D, design improvement, product innovation. You require intellectual inputs, and therefore it's a very short-sighted approach to think that you don't require engineering. Only thing is that current caliber of engineering graduates may not be meeting a requirement. That's why the employability issue comes in. But you definitely require engineering graduates. You require people with with the R&D capabilities. Intellectual input is a very powerful input in competitiveness.
Sorry, sir, I can take an example of the Coal India. They have 12.7 lakh. They don't need so many engineers. They need only hardly 5,000 engineers. Balance are required only class 10 who can go in the mining side.
No, no. Okay, that's a very powerful point. Actually, this is where my, for example, if I share what I have studied, you see, a proactive approach is right now what's happening, because I've been in this business for the last 47 years engineering education, and more recently in private sector. What's happening, there is a crowd, behavior. You just go in and everybody is going in IT, everybody goes in, all parents go into IT. They don't realize that this decision of today to go to IT, 4 years later the outcome would come, by the time the trend may change. And therefore it's only when proactive, if companies are in constant touch with academic institutions and they're able to tell that in future we need, next 3-4 years we need these kinds of people, the kind of manpower planning that you need, so in institutions would be having a right mix of the technical portfolio. In the absence of that, the crowd behavior, everybody is going for IT, and the core technologies are being, IT is at best an enabling technology, and enabling technology cannot replace the core technology, is because of the lack of information on the parents who are simply guided by the crowd behavior. And proactive approach by the companies, handholding, we need so many engineers in next 5 years, so many in mining, so many. So you may be over-employing people, okay, that's your manpower planning issue. But telling the institutions at the national level, AICT, that we require so many core engineers in this region, a very solid data-driven forecast on the technical manpower planning basis, so that the crowd behavior does not carry the show. And therefore, the kind of, if you look at the growth of technical disciplines, is more like hype-driven. In the hype cycle goes in, you're over-emphasizing, and when the expectations don't realize, there's a sudden frustration, there's a trough, and therefore, long-term decisions can't be driven by hype. It has to be solid data-driven, and only proactive involvement of companies telling the institutions what to do, what not to do, what to teach, what not to teach, and this can only happen if you do proactive handholding. And that's why I said that your future is there. Don't ignore it, because they can afford to ignore it. You can't afford to ignore it. This is the point that I was making. This mindset has to change.
To add to
1,200 mining graduates, not a single diploma holder of mining. Now you can imagine.
That's an imbalance. That's a terrible imbalance.
I think very very rightly issue has been raised. I feel there are two perspectives to this. Number one, we do not have a manpower planning data,
that's
as
true,
rightly
true,
said.
True. We don't have
and that. Number two, the skills in our country are not considered to be something respectable. So we are definitely finding shortage of skilled manpower because of the perception of the society that the skill doesn't get the same, I would say, respect as a white-collar job. I think these are together the result of what we are seeing today. I think we'll take over the next question.
Hi, my name is Bhumika. I'm from Deloitte, and I was hearing both Professor Abrat and the industry person, and I realized that both faculty and the industry wants to come together, but there's a certain amount of distrust. So why isn't a platform like CII, where both the institutions can come together, why are we not discussing what how they can contribute in merging this gap? Instead of we understand that industry should be proactive, the academic institutions should be proactive, that is definitely there. But why isn't a third party like an association, CII or ASSOCHAM or something like that, what role they can play to bring the two together?
Okay. Maybe but Mr. Ramesh.
This whole context of this AICT survey is one of that role. See, the interaction not at the national level, but at the state level, zonal level also, we are doing this kind of interactions where we are bringing them together and creating a forum where they let them spill out what issues they have. So that we can find a solution where we can bring them together. See, first and foremost, the factories, they are not meeting. So we are creating a forum where they can meet each other.
That's true.
Then once they meet each other, then the dialogue starts. Then
see, the number of CII institute and industry interaction on academia related are so high. There will be in Coimbatore. It all done at a regional level, sub-region, state level, sub-state level. It's going on. Now I won't be surprised if there is something is taking place tomorrow or day after. Western region does quite a bit. Every region does this. So it is for people to seek out also. See, sometimes what happens is people give a suggestion, why don't you do this, why don't you do this? Now so many things are available on the website.
That's true.
CII has been doing this, university, industry, council and all those things for so long. Everything is available in the web. You should also search. Because ask, it shall be given unto you. So you have to do that also. I thought, because there are so many CII things are taking place.
That's true.
It's a question of somebody has to find a partnership and do it.
Just to add to what
I think one of the consulting firms also involved, I think PwC was involved in one of our surveys also.
Yeah, just to add to what my colleagues have said, we as a regulator have also started a couple of initiatives to have more participation of industry in our teaching. See, so far the regulators were not recognizing perhaps the participation of industry. Rather, we would like to encourage a couple of initiatives. Number one, We have recently launched an adjunct faculty scheme wherein we are asking institutions to come forward with proposals as to how they can have participation of industry in, and we will support that. That is one initiative, and it has recently we have launched a public notification to that. Another important, and which is likely to come, another important initiative which we are likely to enforce, so far we have not taken a final decision, is how we can recognize a faculty with industry background amongst the regular faculty. That also is in under consideration. Hopefully we would be taking a final call on this also. So as a regulator, we feel that their participation in our teaching learning process also makes this initiative.
True, true. I think one more point that as a regulator you could do, and take the analogy from the medical education. For opening a medical institute, you require a hospital to be attached to the college. Unless there is a hospital attached to the college, and that hospital is not a lab, it's a hospital where patients from wherever can come. If an engineering college can only be initiated if there are, there's a company which agrees to join hands with it, like a hospital attached to a medical college, that would ensure that there's at least some common platform, and that you can make them at least come together. That one analogy can do. Second one, the CSR now permits education to be one of the places where you can use this money. Use CSR money, and this CII can support, that let CSR budget be used by individual companies to fund the, let's say, INA fellows and other retired professors from IITs and IIMs to act as mentors of institutions of their choice, and the money should be reasonably good for them to, you know, do a good job, because let that CSR money be used in a very effective way by having mentors appointed out of those role models who have succeeded in life and now, you know, waiting for some engagement in the evening of their life. This would be win-win for them as well. And therefore, this can be done. Use CSR money for appointing, you know, INA fellows, professors of retired professors of IITs, etc., who can actually be role models in inspiring. And they be recognized as mentors, money comes from CSR budget of a company, and let them choose where to go. I mean, it's be convenient for them wherever they are settled. It'll make a difference in terms of giving a major input to the kind of things.
I think to add one point I wanted to add to this discussion. 1 minute.
Can I add something?
All 1 minute. All large industrial groups have their own engineering colleges now.
Yeah, but I have a different point to share, but I think we will take a question first.
See, I wanted to speak because I had been with the academic institution as a professor. I am working with the industry. I know both sides of things. The survey, whatever has been done, it is not comprehensive. You have not seen the best practices. 7 years back, we started talking about industry institute interaction. We are doing it for the last 12 years. Handholding is being talked. I am calling on the behalf of Bharat Forge. I am Senior Director, Kalani Center for Technology and Innovation. We have a world-class research center. We are hand-holding with so many institutions. We are hand-holding BITS Pilani for 12 years. We are running course together, off-campus program. We are supporting with crores of rupees. We are hand-holding with Barwick University, UK for 7 years. Here, Dr. Kakkar is there. And we are hand-holding, we worked with IIT Bombay for 5 years continuously. Now we are having association with so many universities in India and abroad. So the thing is that we are having, but the question comes, if the institutes are coming substandard, one of the president of CII told in Delhi just 1 year ago when he was felicitated in some international and national professors, that so-called engineering institutions coming up in India, maybe so many thousand, the degree is not worth the piece of the paper. So if such institution, why industry should support and handhold actually? When we are doing world level business and we are competitive to anybody in the world, in fact we are number one in our business in the world, we know how to get engineers, and we are handholding about 20 institutions, we have got a talent pipeline. We take engineers from rural engineering colleges, we train them, and then we send them for M.Tech to IIT Bombay, and they are giving us enough support to competitive globally. So the thing is that we should come to the fact, and CSR money being used in education, in CSR money, we installed two ITIs in Maharashtra, and today they are the best ITIs in Maharashtra. First we installed one, in 3 year time it became the best in the state, they requested to install more, we have installed more. In CSR also we are putting But then everything cannot go for education. We are looking for more for sanitation. We are supporting 20 schools and we have changed their entire sanitation there. So there are so many good things we have done in the country, but we will not come and tell, because that's not our culture from Bharat Forge to go and advertise ourselves. But we are, so many people are doing so many good things.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, please.
So he's saying they are doing it.
Achhi baat, if you are doing it, it's good. But I'm sure that you would be happy with that proactive help that you have been doing for 12 years. Have you regretted doing that?
Absolutely.
Absolutely not. Have you regretted doing it? Are you delighted having done that?
Absolutely.
Great. So this becomes one of the success stories which must be replicated in thousands. This proves the point. If you feel that last 12 years a proactive approach has been satisfying to you and has helped so many, indeed this becomes a case example to be replicated in thousands. Because in fact it only proves my point that such a in a sustained proactive help in the long run is going to be win-win. Be good for the organization that you are handholding, good for you and good for the country and the society at large, because a large number of people would get employment. That's the only way you can live with peace in this country.
I like what you have initiated with that extra thing, which is university and academia and recognition of and the awards. I think that should be applauded. And I think as Professor Rajan said, that there's a lot happening in that space. And I've been kind of 90% in India in last 15 years and partly associated with this academy industry initiative. I've been part of IBM team. And I like to think that a lot happens in terms of collaboration and CIA and conference here than other countries. So I think we kind of tend to beat ourselves all the time. Now, question is there a gap between industry and academia? Yes, and not only in here. The gap is there all over the world. But I think through initiatives and thought leadership of both industry here, I see Professor Raj come from a government also that represents industry, academia. I think a lot is happening. I think what is also happening is that because of these deliberations, some of the initiatives are taking in India. I mean, I'm right now working on a new IBM program actually developed in India. And now I'm taking, and already, because it was developed in India, it was given to handful organizations in here, some universities. Now, I'm taking it globally, that this is what industry academia initiative taking place in India, and this is what the engineers are getting taught. Would you not, a large university in Australia, I talked to the VC, would you not like to teach them? Otherwise, there would be no job for Australians. So I think this is an ongoing issue, but I also take your point, sir, that more can be done, and I like to think that more should be done, because we should take a leapfrog approach. I see some examples which Dr. Rajesh talked about, that what you are doing, but I like to think that if India is producing workers for the future, because we are the only young nation, if not today, 5-10 years onwards, then we could be leader in that collaboration, and some of that thinking may have to come from India rather than looking for similar collaboration. And perhaps large companies which happen to be already in India, top 500 Fortune companies are in India, maybe they are right now giving hundreds of millions of dollars to MITs and all those industries, but gradually some of that can also be given to this country. At least some of us, we think that this could be a joint vision. I mean, what are your thoughts in this space?
Can you please once again specifically ask what exactly you had in
like mind? The role with this collaboration which you have started and you started recognizing, if that is taken up and collaboration increased, do you see the multinationals and a Fortune 500, most of them happen to be now in India in last 10 years, leveraging that, is there a possibility of some of those research money and collaboration money and this kind of initiative that take place globally?
Very much.
Some of the money can be gone to the top university colleges in here. I mean, that could be a major motivation for everybody to lift up the game. Colleges from one side, industry from other side participating in it, and you playing the regulator may want to also constantly innovate and allow those courses and industry collaboration. Absolutely. I mean, like 30% of the course what IBM has come up, we're now introducing in the university. Now, more if that can be done in a government-style colleges as well. I mean, right now we are doing it only in private because they say that we can do it. But any government college we go to, no, no, we are affiliated by RTU or GTU or AICTE, and we can't do that. And that becomes, I'm not saying it can be changed because there are rules and reasons for that. But if some of these come together and start acting a little feverishly, so what are your thoughts that can we take not an incremental approach, but a completely transformative approach to industry, academia, collaboration in India?
I think we have already taken up a decision that we need to be more proactive in terms of having more fruitful industry-academia relationship. In terms of participation, we don't make any difference between a government institution or a private institution. Everybody is encouraged to participate. There's no difference between a government institution. In last 3 or 4 years, we have seen that institutions have participated, but our expectations of more and more institutions who have been doing good, but hey, they have not really participated in this particular survey, is something which is an issue of concern. So we would like to see that there are many good institutions. Despite the fact that we have awarded some really outstanding institutions, but there are equally good number of institutions who have not yet been a part of this particular survey. We would like them also to be part of this particular survey so that the information of what good things have been done by these institutions is also known to the other stakeholders, namely institutions. Another important aspect I am just keen to share with all of you here is that very recently, and only yesterday I was reading the paper, we have more number of Indian institutions now coming in the world ranking. This year we have seen the number has increased many fold in terms of university, international university rankings. Even we have launched a national institutional ranking framework where the perception of an institution is also a very important parameter. I think this survey is going to create perception of an institution. Those institutions which have participated, those institutions who have been awarded with different awards in so many categories, I think they would have a very good perception, and that will help them in getting a good ranking framework. And finally, the involvement of industry, we are more keen to have a participation of as many, not only the national companies, multinational companies also. That is our endeavor, and that is the objective with which we have this survey which we have launched. I think that makes it very clear. Can we have some more questions?
Yeah, yeah. Professor Raj. No, one small clarity. I will give towards the end about the survey.
Yeah, please.
After him, then him, I think. Tap it, I said.
Yeah. Hello. Sir, one doubt is this. Regarding this industry and institute collaboration, it is only for like providing the employability opportunities for students or for research opportunities. My question is precise, I think. Like this industry institute partnership, it is for creating employability for students or just for research opportunities for students?
All aspects of the industry.
All aspects.
All aspects.
Absolutely.
In fact, you should see the criteria. The governance, faculty, everything has to improve. One aspect which was mentioned was regarding the employment, but that was not only yet. Joint, research. Finally, they would like to say if they co-produce, we'll be very happy. Okay? It is towards somebody has to be taken. So a mirror is shown where you are. It is like a blood test. You have got some high cholesterol or nothing, some anemia, that type of thing.
Yeah.
Here. I represent the pharmacy sector from the academics. One thing what I observed as part of the survey.
You said if you can hold the mic closer.
A little bit closer to you.
Hello.
Closer to your lips.
That'll be better.
One thing I was able to see in the survey, and also through interactions through my colleagues, in the pharma education, we find there's a big gap between actually what the industry needs and what is happening in the academy. Now, basically, the orientation of the syllabus and other things are not really very very relevant to what is happening in the industry. We are quite old and quite slow in improving things. Now, I think, do you think we could improve it by the industry supporting in such a manner that the faculty get some sort of additional training in the industry, so that over a period of time, maybe short durations of 2 months or 3 months, which the institution or the universities can accommodate for a short period, see that he gets a relevant training, and then he knows what is to be what is to be taught there. So there is a gap there, which I think industries should be able to cover up.
It's true.
And what happens when it comes to framing the syllabus and other things, it is not only the faculty, it is some of the administrators at the university level who are also involved in designing the syllabus and other things. Specifically the practical aspect of it. Theoretical things, so many things go on. But what we see in the practical aspect, there is a huge gap between what is being done there and in the industry. So sensitization of the university officials who deal with academics and also the senior training staff, orientation for them from the industries, I think would be a great help in bringing about more of this interaction. So what is your take on that?
Okay, you after you say, you are going to say something.
No, no.
After. See, it's a very good point. Earlier chairman, one before that, before Mantha, he had told me at that time I was principal advisor in CII. He has told Rajan, but he has signed the MOU between CII and this, try to get some syllabi changes suggested by industry. In fact, knowing so many people, I went on writing and nothing came. So my suggestion is, there's no point of wailing about the past. If you can, take the B pharma syllabus, take the M pharma syllabus. It's not very big. Just say, in fact, knowing what the problem of an academic will be, I told them, use only two. Red, you put delete. Green, you say add. Then the academic will see, okay, I can't introduce without a Faraday's law, I can't introduce motor, then they let him add that. And then you can discuss. None was available. After about 9 months, I left it off. So now my suggestion is those who are in industry, you may request, change it. Civil engineering, we want change in civil engineering, we want change in mining. Do that and send. But what he was ready was, he just put it as a model.
Yes.
Model syllabus. They will adopt. So I would say that this is an attempt should be come from there. Yes, because theoretically, all syllabi are done by a board of study in which an industry participation is there. So that what that person did, God knows. So you, those of you who know, you try to do this. Yes, that applies to you also, sir. If you have whatever experience you have, you please send it, make it, take it correct. Mechanical, this one. Cut it off, red, remove these things, put it. 6 months, 6 months of project is available, not 2 months. 6 months, one semester, full semester is for project.
Hello.
I thought I should put the facts before now. Yes, you kindly say, sir. Right.
Yeah, there's there.
Sir, yeah. May I request one thing? If you can make about 5-6 pages of writing, we would like to put it in our website as an experience.
Hello, sir?
We have only about 5 more minutes. We can have as many queries as possible. Yeah.
Namaskar. Myself, Professor Joshi. Actually, as we know, we have in India some of the universities running a sandwich patterns. Like sandwich means industry and institute collaborations. And even some of the university like SPPU, that is Savitribai Phule University Pune, and some of the university Coimbatore, that is BGS College, are running from so many years sandwich pattern. But the student, like stakeholders, they did not come forward to take the admissions for the first year. Even they have a mindset that is that some they go for prefer for the traditional course like general mechanical engineering, electronics, communication engineering, but they not come forward to take mechanical sandwich or electronic sandwich or electrical sandwich or such kind of course, they will not come forward. So what is the problem and how we can come out of this, and what is the future of that? Even the student they have completed the course, they are facing the problem at the central government job like Indian Army, Navy, such kind of problems. So we have listened already, have seen. So how would they come for means come out from these problems?
To whom you are specifically aiming this query at? To the industry or to the institute? Mr. Ramesh will.
Both it is a request.
Mr. Ramesh,
yes.
can you
repeat the specific question? You
the question pattern. Is this query is about sandwich pattern.
Sandwich pattern is there. The some of the university they are running such kind of patterns. Mm-hmm. Okay, and the student they are not come forward to take the admission for sandwich course. Mm-hmm. Because their mindset is fixed that the traditional course, they are moving to the traditional course like plain mechanical, plain electronics without internship. But in sandwich, we are giving the internship courses, then also the student, they are not come forward to take the admissions. Because they have a problem after the, they are not getting the job at the central level. So how we will come out of this and how we can give a guarantee to the students to take the admissions?
Yeah, one thing is you should understand is in today's situation everything is driven by the market forces. Suppose you look at core engineering, how many of the core engineering are sticking to engineering? Like he has given an example of mining, most of them are going to IT. So the whole context of how the colleges orient themselves is on the market forces, where the market is driving and they are orienting towards that. So the ultimately what happens is there's a lot of social and peer pressure. An example is today's newspaper, I was studying that IIT Kharagpur, Google offered 2 crores. And there's a big hue and cry, the parents have come and protested. That why do you want to advertise it?
That's
true. Google is giving 2 crores, don't advertise it, because there's putting a lot of pressure, psychological pressure on the student also. When your classmate is getting 2 crores, mm-hmm. why you are not getting 2 crores? Why you got only 10 lakh salary or 15 lakh salary? Mm-hmm. So the social peer pressure and the market forces are defining all these things. Suppose you ask my industry, why did we experiment with so many universities, finally stuck to one university? Because it is required for us to grow. Otherwise, if it was 20, 25 years back, we wouldn't have put any effort. Mm. We would have let our industry run as it is. Mm. Because that time the competitive pressures were not there. So everything is driven by the competitive pressure. That you have to understand.
I think he has summed it up very nicely. It's all the market-driven forces which are going to decide what course is needed, what exactly is to be taught in a curriculum. All these things are all market-driven. I think we are coming to the…
Only one small.
Professor Rajan has to.
Just this only a number, because Professor Premrath often was mentioning about 37. The institutions involved was not 37. It's 1, 2, 2, 5. Of course, it is 10% of the total ones, but it is 1,225 institutions, and they also come. There is one good thing about it is they fall in the Gaussian curve. Because if it were only peak on one side, they fall in the Gaussian curve. Then the number can vary here and there. So there are a number of institutions which are around. The 37 was select for the award. That is the only thing. For selection award, you have to cut it down and then visit. So we are taking only 3 or 2 per category.
Yes.
That I just thought I should clarify that point.
And
it need to be improved more. I'm not saying no.
Yeah. Besides that, despite the fact that we have 24 different awards, we have not given awards in all the categories. It's very choosy, very selective, where we have really found that there is a meaningful interaction happening between industry and institution. Only such institutions have been awarded. I think
overall, shows that the problem is very acute.
Yeah, it is acute. There is no doubt. There is always a scope for improvement, and we thank. I think we have come to the end of the time that we have been given. I thank all the panelists, Professor Premwath, Professor Rajan, Mr. Ramesh Datla, and all of you for your wonderful participation in making this panel discussion very successful. Thank you. Thank you one and all. Thank you.